time for Michigan's newest sports talk show, Mitten Madness.
And here he goes, defense win championship.
Michigan sports talk from here in Battle Creek. The latest stories, the biggest games, all across the Mitten State.
That's not something to play with.
Streaming live and on demand on the 95.3 WBCK app. Here are your hosts, Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes.
Hello there. Welcome in to Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK. Jacob Harrison, brand manager of BCK. That's Da'Jzon Hughes, brand manager of the Block 102.5 and 104.9 there in Battle Creek. A lot to get into, as you might have guessed, because it's 9 a.m. if you're listening in the morning. And that means we have 2 hours here in the morning previewing and leading you into live coverage of the game, Michigan and Ohio State. We'll talk plenty about that game in the second hour because that portion of the show will not be available on the replay at 8 p.m. tonight. Also, just as a forewarning, we are recording the show on Tuesday because we both have lives and we both have to travel for Thanksgiving. I'm on the way up from Alabama, I think, at the point of the show being aired. If not, I'm making my way over to Ann Arbor to do some driving around over there. So I know DJ's got his plans as well, but we'll just keep that in perspective as we talk about things. We can't do too much with the Lions. So we're not going to be able to talk a whole lot about the Lions. We'll talk plenty about the Lions next week because there's going to be a lot to cover at that point. In the meantime, we'll be able to cover a lot of things that maybe gets kind of pushed by the wayside, especially since we have more time. We'll also do more picks at the end of the show. So with all of that said, DJ, man, how's it going ahead of the holidays? How you think it's going to go after the holidays?
Dude, as people are hearing this, I am somewhere either playing video games or watching football. So I am through the roof. I'm so excited for the holiday weekend. Like, I'll be in Chicago with family and enjoying that. Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday.
So I was going to ask, Thanksgiving or Christmas?
Yeah, no, I'm a big Thanksgiving guy. It's my favorite holiday.
Like, you saw how much I had for lunch today?
Yeah, I say I don't really like Christmas.
You can tell my favorite.
I don't like Christmas because it overshadows Thanksgiving. Everybody wants to jump right to Christmas after Halloween. But the worst part of everything that's going on is that my fantasy football trend continues. Every time the Green Bay Packers win an NFL football game, I lose a fantasy football game.
Yeah. Both of us had rough weekends in the football world, but mine actually got a little bit better today before we started recording. Matt Canada out as the Steelers offensive coordinator, so it's all good. I mean, I was going to ask the ranking of Thanksgiving and Christmas. For me, I love food so much, and Thanksgiving food is excellent. Christmas does get a little bit of a nudge just because I'm a father. Watching your kids open Christmas presents is an otherworldly feeling, but yeah, Thanksgiving, big one. Also, by the way, football all day on Thanksgiving. Can't wait to watch the Lions games. I'm sure the Cowboys game will be fun and what they've got there in the afternoon as well. Worth noting, if you enjoyed all of the Thanksgiving games on BCK, awesome. Hope you did. Hope nothing went wrong with that, to be honest. We will have more games as we get further into December. It's a selection of games, so you'll just have to keep an ear out of when the games will be coming. I know we have the Army-Navy game is the one college football game that we have, courtesy of Westwood One, and we'll also have the entire NFL playoffs and any Lions games in prime time. If they get flexed into a prime time slot, the Lions will be on WBCK. We will have other prime time games in the meantime as well. Let's get into the college football world to get things started. We will talk at length about Ohio State and Michigan and their place in this a little bit later, but I do want to touch on some of the chaotic things that can happen this weekend and next in the world of college football, because it's very detrimental to Michigan, win or lose against the Buckeyes. A lot of crazy things are going on. 5 undefeated teams heading into rivalry week. Georgia, Ohio State, Michigan, Washington, Florida State ranked in that order on the AP top 25. Oregon, Texas, Alabama, Louisville, the one loss teams in the top 10. From Missouri down, none of those teams have a shot of making any noise, but those 9 teams really all with some semblance of a shot at the playoff. And for this to be the last year of the 4-team playoff, it's kind of a bummer that we don't get the 12 team this year, but goodness, I mean, the fact that we've got such a buffet of really good football teams that can make the college football playoff and potentially win the whole thing is incredibly, incredibly exciting. It's a fun way for that 4-team playoff to go out.
Oh yeah, I'm excited for this 4-team playoff. Like, with everything that shook down last week, it is going to be magic. this week. I mean, we got one of the toughest rivalries ever with Georgia, Georgia Tech. It seems like Tech just plays those guys good every year, even though people think they shouldn't. You have the game, which is named the game for a reason. I don't have to expound on that. The Iron Bowl, Oregon, Oregon State means something with Oregon being ranked. Both of those teams going to bowl games this year. Like,
don't sleep on the Apple Cup, Washington Wazoo.
I say I almost thought about bringing that up, but that's going to be a huge game as well. If Washington State's able to, you know, upset them, that's going to shake up the CFP hugely.
Wazoo has upset Washington when they've had big seasons before.
I was going
to
say, and it wouldn't be too far stretched. Like, that's one of those Auburn-Alabama Iron Bowl, Georgia-Georgia Tech, where, like, the team is just shouldn't be anywhere near in contention, but because of what it means, they're going to be that close. And, I mean, it just sucks that, like, Bedlam isn't this weekend, or, like, Texas-Oklahoma. Like, there's so many big rivalries that get played earlier in the year that, like, they just can't.
Yeah,
you know? Like,
that feels
weird. Michigan-Michigan State's a great rivalry, too, but it'll never get rivalry week because of the game. Like, rivalry, this is what college football is about, the last week of the regular season.
I do want to talk about one thing, and I think people are going to think I'm going to come from a biased situation when I ask about this.
Yes,
and
you are.
I'm really trying not to.
Of course.
But when Ohio State and Michigan get done playing, a playoff spot will open up. There's the distinct possibility that the Big Ten champion, the Pac-12 champion, and the ACC champion are all undefeated. But there's also a chance that Texas and Alabama both win out. And in that scenario, I would anticipate Florida would probably be Florida State in that scenario would probably be number four because of their quarterback situation. But between Texas and Alabama, who have played on a field, and Texas won in week two, and Texas has looked worse than Alabama in those time periods, how weird would it feel for the final four team playoff to not have an SEC team in it if the committee went with the head-to-head? Or would you see it differently? Should they ignore the head-to-head and base it off of how these teams are performing most recent?
I think a lot of people here in the Big Ten would be extremely upset. And a lot of other conferences, too.
At missing out on the SEC?
On the SEC getting a team in. Over Texas.
Okay.
If that's the case.
That's the way I thought it would be.
Because people are like, well, what does head-to-head mean? What does playing football mean if you guys are just going to hand the SEC spots anyway? Like, yeah, they've looked good.
Is it handing it, though?
Yes, they've looked good. Texas has looked bad. But when you look at the records, Texas beat Alabama. So if they both have one loss, Texas is better. Like, this isn't a decision thing. The NFL doesn't make decisions. If you got a tiebreaker, whoever won the head-to-head wins.
The problem, though. There are no tiebreakers.
Exactly. They need to just make tiebreakers. Very simple. The first one should be head-to-head. Then the next one should be, like, interconference, you know, whatever. Like, there's a way to make head-to-heads, which then I think almost gets rid of the strength of schedule conversation, because then people are just going to go schedule the best of the best to have the head-to-head overset.
Like, yeah, I think
there are ways to make this work in the way that everybody wants it to. I just don't think the committee would like to give up their power.
Yeah, well, I think we'll see how things change when it's 12 teams in the future, but I think out-of-conference scheduling does take a hit if Alabama gets in over Texas in the scenario that I just drew up. And certainly, as an alum of the University of Alabama, I will not be upset if my team is in the college football playoff, but I'd certainly understand the gripe of anybody else that would see it that way. However, I would caution the outrage of that, because in that scenario, Alabama did beat the number one team in the land right before the playoff. And conference championships are de facto playoff games, especially in the SEC.
But that's just bias. That's bias.
That is I will agree. That's a bias statement.
You got to get rid of bias. Like, if you want this to truly work, bias has to leave. And it has to simply be football.
Yeah.
Who has the best record? Who beat who? No matter your conference.
I will say, I think every team in the top nine has looked incredible at times and has looked like what at times as well. And I think all nine teams have a very significant grasp of things as far as a path to the playoff. But they all will also be kicking themselves if things don't go their way. Hey, look at number nine, Louisville. Florida State just lost their quarterback for the year. Now, Florida State's backup quarterback could be just as good as Jordan Travis. Not likely. Jordan Travis was a Heisman candidate. Or he could be just as good as, say, a Mac Jones at managing a team in college football.
Thank you for the distinction.
At managing a team and taking that team where it needs to go on the back of some excellent playmakers. But they lost to Pitt. And for Texas, it's the same thing. They've got some big wins under their belt, but they've also got some clunkers where they really should have lost to Kansas State. Oregon, they may have a chance to rectify their loss to Washington. They could also just get bounced this weekend against Oregon State. I think it's just about as fun of an end of season as college football has had since going to the 4-team playoff. It's very exciting.
Yeah, I mean, and this is a great way to like start to look at what the 12 could look like. Because like right now with the 12, just taking out, you know, the Pac-12 because they won't be here next year. Georgia, Ohio State, Michigan, or Georgia, Michigan, Florida State probably get in. That's me being a homer and believing that Ohio, Michigan will beat Ohio State and go on to win the Big Ten championship.
I think you're looking at the top 11 in the AP.
No.
And Tulane.
No.
Would that not be it?
Not necessarily.
Your power conference winners won.
Well, there's only four power conference winners now.
Right. And then the one non-conference or group of five and then the rest.
Supposedly the next six. But that's why the committee is still around, because the committee gets to decide who the best next six are.
Well, how would they not choose in this scenario if Michigan were to win? Let's just presume it that way.
Because they decide to
How would it not be Ohio State, Oregon,
the same way that
Texas, Louisville, Missouri, and Penn State?
Because the same way that they're supposed to have been two Big Ten teams in the past and they decided to put in two SEC teams. Because the committee wants to. The committee gets to decide what they want to do.
I think sometimes you Big Ten fans discredit how good the bottom of the SEC is. Not counting Vanderbilt.
I mean, we're not saying the SEC isn't good, but that doesn't necessarily just automatically grant them to, like,
true.
A one-loss Michigan team is better than, in my opinion, better than a two-loss SEC school.
I think that's a fair assessment, but I think...
But they're going to...
A big argument in SEC country is that a 3-9 Arkansas team would go 6-6 easily in the Big Ten.
No.
Yes.
No. See, that's just ludicrous.
I just wanted to say that on the radio.
And that's what all of the... That's what all of the committee members and stuff think, too. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. We'll find out soon.
I think it just means more.
We'll find out soon.
Let's go to break. When we come back, plenty more to get into. Lions coming up. Michigan, Ohio State as well. We're also going to dive into some Michigan State stuff with their coaching search and some information in that regard. Here next on Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK. Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK. Want to shift gears a little bit in the college world and talk a little bit about Michigan State. The Spartans were able to pick up a 3-point win over Indiana, so they're no doubt most likely going to lose to Penn State later today. No harsh feelings. That's just probably the way that one's going to go at Ford Field, 7:30 p.m. if you're interested in that sort of thing. Of course, as soon as that game is over, Michigan State season is over. There is no bowling for this team, obviously, with such a bad record. In that, with that being the case, Michigan State will need to find its next head coach. Obviously, with things happening with Mel Tucker and so on and so forth, they need to have things figured out. Was looking through ESPN, stumbled upon an article, the ranking the open college football jobs. Michigan State comes in at number 2 behind Texas A&M. Obviously, A&M has a little bit more recent success than Michigan State does. Nonetheless, the state job is open. Some candidates to maybe keep an ear out, according to Adam Rittenberg of ESPN, is Oregon State coach Jonathan Smith. You could also look toward Colorado analyst Pat Shermer, who is a Michigan State alum, former NFL coach. So those are probably the two to look at. My question is, do either of those move the needle for you, DJ? Do you have somebody else in mind, possibly? And do you agree? This is a real loaded shotgun question, but do you agree with it being the second best open job in all of college football? Is it really, with everything this school, this university, and this program has had to deal with over the past several years, is it really that enticing for anybody, especially if we're not talking some of the biggest names in college football to come take this job?
You know you should ask me this kind of question. I'm so biased. Like, no.
like, what did you tell me last segment? You got to put the bias away.
Okay, let me throw it away. In all retrospect, probably Pat. Truly, like, he's got a good mind for football. He knows what's going on out there, and he cares about the university because he went there. Like, he's the kind of guy that you want to bring back and reestablish, you know, like culture. He knows what old Michigan State culture was like, what it was like when the football team was good, what it was like when Tom Izzo had the basketball team at the top of the country. Like, you need a guy like that to come back in and be like, hey, look, we're not doing what's been happening the last 8 years, 9 years. We're going back to this. This is what our university is about when it comes to football, comes to discipline, comes to this, comes to that. And we're going to get back to that so that we can be the Michigan State Spartans. And so far, they haven't had anyone do that. It's kind of just been, hey, we're going to go out and try and put out a good product in the field, but we just got to beat Michigan. And, well, we can't do that either. So, oh, well. Like, they need somebody to come in and be like, we are going to get back to the top because we're going to go back to doing things the Michigan State University way.
I think Pat Shurmur makes a lot of sense having that connection with being an alum. But a guy that is already kind of in that position is interim head coach Harlan Barnett. Just 56 years old, so you know, nothing to worry about in that regard. And he was quoted as saying, as far as the job itself and wanting the job, and I do want the job as the head coach, head football coach, there's nobody that they can go find that loves this place more than I do. And I don't think we'll do a better job because there is something to loving a place and caring about a place as opposed to just going there for a job. And I think that is that's a profound statement. Now, look, that's the kind of thing you'd expect him to say is, you know, obviously he's an alum. He cares about the place, so on and so forth. They have won 2 conference games, which seemed impossible at points in this season. I haven't thought that they were going to win any game that they have went into since they got out of conference play. Do you think that would also be a solid direction as well? Or does Barnett just not carry the name weight required to be successful in the Power 5? Because remember, Michigan State's problems don't exist just on the football field or behind closed doors, to be emphatic about it. They don't recruit well, and they have not recruited well in a long, long time. And if you don't carry name weight, you're already handcuffed in the world of recruiting.
And I mean, they're going to continue to stay that way. What they need is a huge upset season. They need an upset season. Like, they got to go out and beat Michigan, or maybe go out and beat Washington, Oregon, USC, Penn State, Ohio State. Like, that is what always gets them back to that realm, is they go out and they beat somebody they shouldn't beat.
Isn't it harsh that they did that just 2 years ago?
Yeah. Yeah, and they were almost there. They had
exactly the season you're talking about.
They were starting to make a comeback.
Yeah.
And they were starting to get players, and then I think there were rumblings about what was happening there on campus, and then guys started to go to different places. Like, I think there were some guys who were looking at Michigan, Michigan State, Ohio State, Penn State, and they chose one of the other 3 schools because they're hearing, you know, X, Y, and Z is going on. They just, like, to me, Michigan State needs a fresh start.
And don't forget all the transfers that they lost as well. That roster right. got gutted last year.
And that's what I mean is, like, I think they just need a fresh start completely from the beginning. Like, hey, anybody who has been here while Tucker was here, or maybe even the coach right before Tucker too, you got to go. Like, it's nothing against you. It's not that you aren't a good coach or anything like that, but you still have pieces of those teams, still have remnants of that culture, and it spreads. And that's the kind of culture we don't need. Maybe you're able to come back here and coach for us later in the future after we've reestablished a new culture that we can then pour into you and have you be a part of. But I think they have to get rid of that old culture that's there and start with something completely fresh.
Shifting gears to the basketball program, which is a little bit more of a bright spot, but it's been, that bright spot's been a little dull to start the season. Lost to James Madison, lost to a top 10 ranked Duke. Since we've last talked, they've got a comfortable win over Butler. Really, I don't think you can shake an eye at. I mean, Butler is one, you know, a name recognized program, and a emphatic win over Alcorn State. Since we've recorded, they have played Arizona on Thanksgiving. We don't know the outcome of that game. That is a very tough game. Obviously, the number 3 Wildcats. Michigan State's fallen all the way to 21 after just 5 games. You know, talking around this program as the way that we can, I mean, you still have to lean on Tyson Walker. He's your big time player and everything, but like, where does this team go, win or lose, after this Arizona game? Obviously, you know, neutral court and all that sort of stuff. Not long after that, you're going to start conference play. What are the things that Michigan State needs to get right on the basketball court to correct ship? Because this is supposed to be the bread and butter of their athletic program, and so far it's faltered.
I think they just have to play basketball. Like, this team is very, very talented. They have the pieces. They have a guard in A.J. Hogarth who knows what he's doing and how to control the game. They have big men down low that can get up high, get poster dunks, grab rebounds, handle the pace down low. They have wings that can shoot the ball. They just have to play like it. I think they're still adjusting into the season, into new teammates. It's not something we're used to seeing with the Michigan State Spartans basketball team, but I think this team will be just fine, and they'll find their way into the top half of the top 25 again, and they're going to be probably sitting around somewhere between a 1 and a 4 seed when the tournament comes around, giving them a very good shot at making a solid Elite Eight kind of run, if not farther, in the NCAA tournament.
Heading back to Michigan, the Wolverines, you talked very highly about the Wolverines basketball program, and they, I think they might have let you down a little bit there with a stunning loss to Long Beach State. Since we have talked, a Memphis game, or excuse me, since we've recorded a Memphis game, they've got a game against Oregon to look forward to at the start of December, and then it's Big Ten play for them. Same question, except, you know, Michigan has looked a bit brighter, obviously. I think there's reason to have a little bit more anticipation for good things to be surprising for them, but nonetheless, I mean, you can't go losing games to Long Beach State.
My thing with the Long Beach State loss is I agree you can't necessarily lose those games, but it comes down to the fact that Michigan doesn't have a takeover guy right now.
Right.
There isn't a guy that's like, hey, I need to control this game right now, and this is how I'm going to do it. They had that with Hunter Dickinson, and now they have to find a new one. I think Doug McDaniel is starting to show those pieces where he's like, okay, we need a bucket. I'm going to go get it. Or, oh, this game's going too fast. Let me slow it down. Let's run our offense, and let's control the pace of the game. He's starting to show those things, but not enough to the point to where he can really control a game, slow it down, and decide if Michigan's going to win or lose, like we saw with Trey Burke back in 2014. He's showing Trey Burke-like things, just not quite there yet. So I'm excited to see where he does go once he decides that he wants to fully take over.
I think that is an interesting aspect of that is Doug McDaniel's numbers kind of stack up with Tyson Walker. Just comparing them, Walker 23-4-6-1-8, and with McDaniel's 21-6-2-1-2, they're really not that far off. You know, one fewer game. Tyson Walker doesn't turn the ball over nearly as much. But when you're looking at things like that, and I've sung the praises because it's a name that I recognize, and I know he did good things down in Tuscaloosa. Namari Burnett is a fantastic piece to pair along with a guy like Doug McDaniel that can get it done in that way. I can't pronounce Olivier's last name, but that's also a name that I recognize as a guy that can get things done as well. So I think there's pieces here, and I'll say this as well. As a budding college football guy that starts to learn to pay attention over the past several years, when you lose those kind of games, they can wake you up or they can be extremely detrimental to what you want to do. And I think with Michigan State, it was extremely detrimental to what they wanted to do. They didn't have enough time to get between a loss to James Madison to playing a top 10 team in Duke to turn things around. With Michigan, they've got time before they even play somebody thinking of being ranked in the top 25. So they've got time to shake out what went wrong against Long Beach State. I think the Iowa game might be the toughest thing they've got, you know, before they get deep into conference play. You've got time. And I think that's the best thing that Michigan could ask for.
Yeah, it just gives them time to get into everything that they like to do and then really decide what they're going to be as a team. And I'm really excited just to see Doug McDaniel continue to show why he's such a great point guard and why he was kind of that hidden gem that Coach Howard was able to go grab.
We're not far away from college basketball starting to get very intense and very interesting when conference play gets started in early December. We'll talk Lions next on Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBC 28.
Detroit sports fans, Wolverines and Spartans alike, this is your sports show, Mitten Madness, with Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes on 95.3 WBCK.
Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK. Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes. If you've been wondering where Coach's Corner has been all morning, they're on break for the Thanksgiving holiday. Bill Broderick will be back at Lakeview Ford next week at 9 a.m. for another live edition of Coach's Corner to get us ready for the high school basketball season as it gets started there in December and then picks back up once class is back in session in January. Let's talk some Lions. Not a lot that we can get into as we preface at the start of the show. We're recording on Tuesday, so we just got done with the Bears game where the Lions didn't perform quite as well as we had expected. And also your Packers won, DJ, so that kind of sets up a completely different game for us on Thursday with the Thanksgiving game where the Lions are looking to have a winning record as early as really they ever have. They're 8-2 for the first time in over 60 years. The other four times that they went 8-2, they also went 9-2. So they immediately won the next week, but they've only made headway in the postseason once. And that was, I believe in 56 when they won the NFL championship. So as far as the ins and outs of games, those are things that we can't really touch on, but what we can do is look at the team as a whole and where we're seeing them go. They did look kind of porous against the Bears, and I think that's worth taking note of, but we saw maturation out of Jameson Williams, I think. We saw Jahmyr Gibbs continue to be a dynamic piece, and we saw David Montgomery yet again really take control of a football game, and you and I were both so low on Montgomery at the start of the season, and to see how dominant he is, sure, he's got a great offensive line. Give him all the credit for that. Sure, he's in an offense that wants to run the football the way that he needs it to be run, but I think it's wildly impressive what they're doing. Even when Jared Goff throws three interceptions, they can just run the ball, you know, in the final minutes to get down the field and get a score in to take the lead on the ground behind David Montgomery. So I mean, offensively, there's a lot to be excited about. Defensively, I'm just waiting for CJ Gardner-Johnson to get back, but Aiden Hutchinson is still doing some fun stuff. Just kind of overall outlook on the team with the second best record in all of the NFL after the loss for the Chiefs last weekend.
The biggest thing is I think that the passing game has to continue to get moving for the Lions. As long as they're able to get Jameson Williams getting open in the end zone and Goff is able to find him, as long as Jahmyr Gibbs is able to rattle off 13, 15-yard receptions, as long as Amon-Ra St. Brown continues to be in the perfect spot at the perfect time to pick up a 3rd-and-12 that he has no business picking up, if Sam LaPorta continues to be that under route that Goff can safely go to every single play if no one else is open, this team will continue to get better. I only say that because let's look back a couple weeks ago when they ran into the Ravens and they were super run heavy at the time. That's fine. You can be a run heavy football team. It works. We've seen it work at all levels of football. But what happens when you run into another run heavy team in football? One that's been run heavy a lot longer than you've been run heavy. One who knows you win in the trenches, no matter what kind of game you play. The Ravens simply just out-toughed them in the trenches on both sides of the ball. That is the reason why they lost that game so bad. They were literally just pushed over in the trenches. But allowing your offense to have a double-headed attack where you can run the ball with two very good running backs, or you can decide to spread it out and throw the ball and still move the ball down the field, forces the game to be a little more open, allows you to have some control. But if you're just going to be in the trenches and just run, do a run game where it's, hey, the team that gets 150 rush yards first is going to win the game, you better be ready for it. And that those lines got to get a little beefier if that's going to be the case, because you're going to run into teams like the Ravens, the Eagles, who run the ball and they know they got to win in the trenches, and you're not going to win that game.
All right, that's where I wanted to kind of go next. I mean, when we're talking about the Lions, they have the second best record in football, but that also means they have the second best record in their own conference. They're going to win the division, right? I think both of us anticipate that they've won this Packers game and that they're 9-2 at the moment that this show is airing. We're both anticipating that they sweep the Bears. We both anticipate that they should handle the Vikings, even with all the Josh Dobb magic that's going on over in Minnesota. But that means that when you make the playoffs, sure, you're going to have to deal with teams like whoever wins the chaotic nature of the NFC South, or the Dallas Cowboys, or maybe even the Seattle Seahawks again, who are one of the two losses you have. But what you're really hoping to do is to match up with either the Philadelphia Eagles or 49ers and potentially both in a playoff run. And both of those teams are built very similarly to what Baltimore does, which is that second loss. And I know you just hyped up the trenches for the offensive side. The defensive side is the side that worries me. And both of those teams, they're dominant on the trenches on both sides of the ball, like the Ravens are. And the Ravens are that way because of mentality. The Eagles and the 49ers are that way because of mentality and talent. Does that concern you at all when projecting? Because this is one of the most exciting seasons Detroit's ever had. But you're looking at two of the probably best teams in the NFL or in your conference and standing in the way of doing something extraordinarily special when it comes to a postseason run.
No, I think you have to take this season for what it is. Right? Don't take it for granted. Literally take it for what it is. I talked about this over on the block earlier this week in terms of celebrating. Mm. You cannot elevate until you celebrate. So therefore, enjoy this year. Celebrate this year. Celebrate every win. At the end of the season, go, we had a winning season. We made the playoffs. That's something we haven't done since XYZ. Celebrate this year. So next year, as soon as you get done celebrating, you automatically want to elevate. That's what it does. Like, you like the feeling of celebrating and doing something good, so you want to do it again. The Lions just have to celebrate this year, so then they can wipe it. And then immediately after they celebrate, they're going to go, okay, what were our weak spots? Where can we get better? Mm. What do we need to do? Who do we need to go get? And then next year, you are looking to actually make a run in the playoffs. And maybe you get to the NFC Championship game next year and you lose. That's fine. Celebrate you made it to the NFC Championship game, reevaluate, and maybe you make it to the Super Bowl the next. Wherever they go, they celebrate this year for what it was, and then they look to elevate.
I think they've done a good job of all of that. I will preface this by saying the Lions, they want to win a Super Bowl, right? They're not into this whole, we made it right now, right? I think once that, if that is what ends up happening, I think that's the way that they'll look at it. But I think the organization as a whole has done a good job of saying, hey, this is how we finished. We can get better. Or, you know, hey, we did this good thing. And I think when we get those peeks into the locker room, you know, Goff always says that's how many wins we've got. You know, probably said after the Bears game, that's eight. You know, they're very aware of what they're doing. You know, they're not overlooking it. They're not putting it down. They're not overshadowing it. They're aware. They're the Detroit Lions and they're 8-2. And that is something to be acknowledged. But I think ultimately, I don't think it's in their best interest to look ahead either. You know, it's our job to look ahead and look at the Eagles and the 49ers and be like, whoa, how do the Lions stack up and make radio content out of it. For the Lions, their priority as we're recording right now is to get ready for the Green Bay Packers. And as this show is airing, getting ready for the New Orleans Saints. It's for them, it's being in the moment and understanding what that moment is. And I think they did a really good job against the Chiefs. I think the two times they didn't do a good job of that were the Seahawks, where they were overtly hyped for the moment, with it being their first home game with all of the momentum that they had. And obviously the Ravens game where, all right, this is our first chance to play a really good team, and they got gobsmacked. So I think for them, it's being in the moment, handling the moment, understanding that they are worthy and they are talented enough to be where they're at and continue to build off of that rather than any sort of looking ahead or any overt, you know, oh, we've never been here kind of thing. You're good enough to be here. Just play like it, and I think they'll be all right.
Yeah, I don't think that's the case at all, honestly, for this Lions fan. I think it's the exact opposite. I think they almost feel too good about where they are. You know, like, the players know they're that good. The fans have been waiting for this. Everybody's super excited about it. So I agree. I think they do a very good job of living in the moment. There's just some things they aren't quite ready for because of maybe coaching or just the team just flat out beat them. And that happens. You know, like, that's just part of football. Sometimes you just get beat. And speaking of getting beat, we'll be coming back after the break talking about the Pistons, who haven't won in forever, and the Red Wings, who listened to every word I said on the pod and have somehow figured out how to lose every game in overtime instead of winning them. So we'll be back with more Mitten Madness after the break on 95.3 WBCK.
95.3 WBCK.
Back on Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK. If you're listening in the morning, we got one more hour to go. If you're listening on the night replay, this is the final segment. You can head over to WBCKFM.com and check out the podcast center to catch the entire show. If you want to hear what we talked about with the Wolverines and Ohio State Buckeyes game, as well as our picks, you can also download the 95.3 WBCK app to do just the same. You can catch the show every single week there as well, and listen live to any of your favorite WBCK programming live, or as well as Community Matters and Coach's Corner replays at any given time. Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes, we're going to talk Pistons and Red Wings in this segment, and make sure we pay our dues to them a little bit. Similar with many others, games are going to be played in between our recording and the airing of the show, so there is only so much that we can do. Let's start with the Pistons. On Monday, Cade Cunningham candidly called his team bad. He said, "We're bad." At that point, they were in the midst of an 11-game losing streak. At the time of this recording, that is a 12 game losing streak, and quite honestly, it could get much, much worse. Reading an article, saw where the Pistons have lost 36 of their last 40 games as of Tuesday, dating back to February. They lost by 4 to Denver without Nikola Jokic, who was ejected from the game, and Reggie Jackson, ironically enough, was the guy that kind of helped lead Denver to the victory. Detroit on the scoreboard, outside of the Raptors lost 142-113. That's ugly. Outside of that game, has kept most of these relatively close, but nonetheless, that gap just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger between the win and the loss column. And at this point, Detroit's the youngest team in the league. They've got a new head coach. They're still gelling. There's plenty of promise. But at some point, Doc, you got to win. You got to start stacking some dubs. You had some early. You're not winless. The two wins against the Hornets and the Bulls, not two of the better teams. You've since lost to the Bulls, but goodness gracious, something's got to give. And I think Cade Cunningham's kind of doing all he can at this point. And there's some other pieces on the team, but more's got to happen. DJ, how do you see it for the Pistons at this juncture in the season?
Hear me out. Maybe Monty Williams is the problem.
15 games into his tenure?
This team has so much potential. It does. There's good pieces on this team from top to bottom. Not necessarily the last guy, but when you look at the guys who are getting play time, they can compete. Marcus Sasser, Cade Cunningham, Jaden Ivey, Jalen Duren, Marvin Bagley, Bogdanovich, Asar Thompson. These guys are good enough to compete with the teams that they're losing to. Now, I'm not saying that this Pistons team should be going out beating the Bucks, beating the 76ers, beating the Celtics, beating the Suns. No, but you should be competitive or beating the Thunder, the Hornets, the Bulls. Let me look at a few of these other NBA teams, because there's some that are slipping off the top of my head. The Trailblazers, the Kings. Not the Rockets. The Rockets have low-key been balling recently. The Grizzlies, the Pelicans, the Magic. The Magic crushed the Pistons, and it shouldn't have been that way. Like, these are teams that you have to be competing against because they're around your not only skill level, but age level as well, which means if you're not progressing faster than those teams are, you're not ever really going to make that leap. That is what this is about, is maybe he doesn't know how to put the right five on the floor. Not that he doesn't know how to coach, or he doesn't know, you know, what he's doing, but that's your main thing as an NBA coach. You're not doing too much player development and things of that nature. You're more so managing the game and the referees, and then putting the right five on the floor. And so far, it seems like Monty Williams hasn't been able to find those 2 to 3 five-player combinations that work. If you look at NBA teams and even college basketball teams, you see that coaches have found 2, 3, and sometimes 4 five-player matchups that work well for his team in different scenarios. And it seems like Monty Williams just hasn't done that yet.
It's a long season, and you've got time to figure those kinds of things out. The slate ahead, the one game that's between our recording and the airing of the show is, as you're listening to this, last night's game at Indiana. Take on the Pacers. That's certainly a winnable game. Monday, Washington. The Wizards are one of the other worst teams in the NBA, so that's obviously an opportunity to get back on the winning stretch. Unfortunately, you follow that up on Wednesday with the visit from the Los Angeles Lakers. Good luck with that. I mean, any given day, right? The NBA is very similar to the NFL in that. I mean, you know, you can pull off what you can pull fell off. Knicks and Cleveland round out the end of the month and get us into the first weekend of December before a long 9-day break for the Pistons. It's hard to garner momentum when you're not beating teams that you should beat. And there's been plenty of teams on this schedule to this point that they could have gotten some victories in. Certainly on the scoreboard, it looks as though it was close enough, but also in the talent department, they're good enough to beat a lot of these teams head up. And it doesn't just have to be teams that are so below 500 like they are, like Charlotte and Chicago and Washington. It doesn't have to be that way. But at the moment, that's kind of what it is. But I agree with you. I mean, there's a ton of potential. There's a ton of talent. I'm not so sure that I understand the NBA operates completely different with its coaches. Seems like dudes get fired no matter how good they are out there. 15 games in, it's hard for me to immediately point at the coach and be like, yeah, he can't do this out of an 82 game season. But at some point, I do think there's a lot of credence in what you're saying. At some point, you've got to be able to put out matchups and put out lineups and things that work for this team. You've got a superstar in Cade Cunningham. He's playing exactly how he needs to. But you've got to put the help around him in a way that makes sense. And I think that is something that, you know, I think you've got a strong point in. If that's not the case, then somebody who can make those decisions properly is what needs to be had. But, something that Williams said in that piece on ESPN, where Cade Cunningham so candidly said, no, we're bad and we've got to address it. One of the things that Monty Williams said was he thinks a few of the guys are dealing with how hard the league is, and when you're dealing with it, the one thing you can't control is your competition level. And Cunningham kind of came back on that and said that should be the last thing that needs to be asked of us or talked about, is how hard we're competing. That should be a given. They're the youngest team in the league. They're scrapping and clawing for everything. Do you think there's kind of a disconnect there in the optics of the team from the coach and from the superstar player? Is this just the grumblings of the team being where it is and not necessarily where it thought it could be? I mean, the level of competition is what it is. You're the youngest team in the league. Who cares? You're all good enough to be in the NBA, and you've all shown flashes of potential. Sure, when you have to play a Toronto or a Phoenix or a Golden State or a Los Angeles Lakers team, you're not going to be favored, but you can still go out there and fight. You can still go out there and put up, you know, points and numbers and give the fans of Detroit reason to believe in the potential that you have, or you can go out there and lay over. And I don't think they've laid over at all. So I don't think they're scared by the level of competition. They're just learning how to catch up to it. How do you see it?
Once again, that's why I said this may be a Monty Williams problem, is they're young. You know your team is young. So find the best combinations to ease some of that catching up. Like, you're throwing, look at the roster. Basically a rookie Cade Cunningham, because he's barely played his first 2 years. A rookie or Sarah Thompson. You know, like, there is no veteranism on your starting lineup. You basically put five young guys out there and said, go ball. Like, of course they're struggling. You haven't set them up to succeed. And I'm not saying Monty Williams is a bad coach or he can't do it. I'm just saying he isn't doing it. I think he's very capable of doing it because he just did it with the Suns. Granted, they had a different set of players, but it still takes time learning your players and then putting the five out that in the best scenario at every time. So he knows how to do it, or he wouldn't be an NBA coach. He just doesn't know how to do it yet with this group. And I think that's the one thing that this group is missing. They have the effort. They have the energy. They have the skill and the IQ. They're adjusting to the game of the NBA, and they need a coach that's going to put them in winning scenarios. Not saying that these two don't match. It just has to happen.
Shifting over to the Red Wings, I'm going to be very blunt here. The Red Wings, since we last talked, had a win over Columbus, a overtime loss to Ottawa, both of those games ending in a final score of 5-4, and a loss to Toronto. Actually, that's not since the last time we lost, but those are the last three games. Since the last time DJ and I talked is just the Toronto game. Between now and the airing of the show will be the New Jersey game, the Boston game, and then they'll be setting up for Minnesota at home at the Little Caesars Arena. The loss to Toronto, not in overtime, just a 3-2 loss. Detroit's still putting up points, but they are not. It feels like they're kind of leveling out at this point. Is that kind of the concern here for you? I'm just looking at how their record has fallen from, you know, 5-1 on top of the world. Everybody is clamoring about this team. You've now got 4 overtime losses, which is fine, but you've got, three overtime losses, 1 overtime win. But, and that kind of helps with the fact that you're now basically below 500. But overall, I mean, the outlook of this, sure, they're scoring points, but you still got to win. And we're kind of nearing that halfway point in a sense of the first half of the season. I guess I should say you've got a big game here against Boston. Overall, I mean, I think there's reason to be a little bit trepidatious that maybe the Red Wings just started hot and now teams are kind of aware of them. Do you get that feeling or
no?
Am I way off base?
No, they're in a far better position than they were last year just off the simple fact that they're losing games in overtime. They're losing games by 1 goal. They're not losing games by 3, 4 goals, 5 goals, not putting up goals. Like, I don't think they've been shut out yet this year. They've been shut out once, twice this year. Twice. Including the preseason, they've been shut out twice. That is huge for this team, something they were not doing last year. Oftentimes, they were getting shut out last year. So I think that's the thing. And they're now progressing into a space where they're being competitive in every game and they're making a next step up. It sucks to not win some of these games, but it is not a end-all, be-all for them because they're trying to make it back to where they used to be, a team that made the playoffs every single year. They had a 25-year playoff streak. It's going to take time to get back to that, but I think they're in a very good spot. We are not running out of time, but we got important news to get to.
Uh-oh.
The game is right around the corner. And before we run out of time and it comes on here, we got to let you know what we're feeling, what we got to say, and who's going to win. So after a short break, we're talking the biggest thing.
95.3 WBCK, keeping you informed and entertained 24/7. WBCK Battle Creek, a Town Square Media station.
Fingers still crossed. I'm Paul Stevens, Fox News. Skepticism rising on whether the Qatar-brokered temporary ceasefire between Israel and Hamas will be fully honored.
Seems at this point that the ceasefire is holding, but there are some new concerns of what's taking place on the northern front. We heard sirens this morning. So this is the northern part of Israel in the conflict with Hezbollah. And while that is a separate conflict, there are widespread concerns it could grow out into a much larger regional conflict. We did hear sirens today, which is an unfortunate change of events, considering that yesterday we had not. Yesterday was relatively calm. So we'll have to keep an eye on that. But it appears, as of right now, the conflict in Gaza, the war there, both sides appear to have been abiding by the ceasefire.
Fox's Alex Hogan in Jerusalem. This coming as the world waits on another possible hostage release. North Korea claiming its newly launched spy satellite is providing the country's leader with a lot to look at.
Kim Jong-un at least twice this week visited the country's aerospace control center to view images from the country's first spy satellite launched last Tuesday. Images purportedly including the city of Seoul and military installations in South Korea, the aircraft carrier, the USS Carl Vinson, and images from Pearl Harbor and Hickam Air Force Base. The U.S., Japan, and South Korea have all condemned the satellite launch as destabilizing to the region, even as doubts linger about its true reconnaissance capabilities. Jack Callahan, Fox News.
Derek Chauvin, the ex-police officer convicted of killing George Floyd, is seriously hurt after an inmate stabbed him in an Arizona prison yesterday, according to a report from the AP. Prison employees performed, quote, life-saving measures before taking Chauvin to a local hospital. He's currently serving a 21-year sentence and a 22-year sentence simultaneously in connection with the death of George Floyd. America's listening to Fox News.
Jason in the House, the Jason Chaffetz Podcast. There is always someone doing something stupid somewhere. Dive deeper than the headlines and the party lines as I take on American life, politics, and entertainment. Join me, Jason Chaffetz, every Wednesday as I shed light on the news and make some predictions along the way. You never know who will drop in. Subscribe now on FoxNewsPodcast.com or wherever you download podcasts.
Connect to Fox News Audio and the Fox News app. Listen to hear your favorite hosts like Brian Kilmeade, Jimmy Fallon, and Guy Benson standing up for what's right live and via podcast. Just click listen, then swipe right and hear the latest news updates on your time. And scroll down to hear the latest podcasts from Fox News. And it's even easier to listen in the car with Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Get programming alerts and notifications. Fox News Audio is on the Fox News app, the voices America trusts. Download it.
It's time for Michigan's newest sports talk show, Mitten Madness.
And here he goes. Defense wins championship.
Michigan sports talk from here in Battle Creek. The latest stories, the biggest games, all across the Mitten State.
That's not something to play with.
Streaming live and on demand on the 95.3 WBCK app. Here are your hosts, Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes.
Hour two of Mitten Madness starts now. Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes here on 95.3 WBCK. We've got 1 hour to go until the kickoff of the game. Michigan, Ohio State, number three, number two in the Big House. Michigan looking for their third straight victory over Ohio State. The Buckeyes obviously ranked a bit higher, looking to stave off Michigan. Michigan's got plenty of off-the-field things that could be discussed, but at the end of the day, when it comes down to it, two of the best teams in the country are going to play a football game here in just a little bit, and it's going to be a ton of fun to watch it all unfold. Michigan is a three-point favorite at home. They have a 54% chance of winning on the matchup predictor on ESPN, the over-under if you're interested in that, 46.5. Let's get into it. With the Michigan Wolverines, obviously they're led offensively by J.J. McCarthy, Blake Corum, and Wilson at receiver. Roman Wilson, who was injured in the previous game against Maryland in the first quarter, didn't return in that game. The anticipation is that he'll be back and be completely fine to contribute here. Offensively for the Ohio State Buckeyes, it's Kyle McCord in his first go at it in this rivalry. Travion Henderson and, of course, Marvin Harrison Jr. on the outside are some of the other big names to watch. You've watched those guys all year long. You know everything there is to know about them. Both these teams have been tested by the Big Ten. Both of them have handled tough matchups with Penn State and other programs within the conference in roughly the same kind of way. Michigan, that big third quarter team, don't allow much there except against Maryland. Ohio State did have an easier time last week with their win over Minnesota. Maryland, a bit tougher of a matchup for Michigan, one of the closer games they've had all year. Back-to-back close games, really and truly, for the Wolverines. DJ, I open the floor up to you, man. I mean, just initial thoughts on the game and how you anticipate things playing out throughout the early portions of the game as well.
Oh, man, I am so excited for this game. Like, it's going to come down to basically who wants it more, and the beginning of the game is going to be a huge part of that. I'm going to look at it, obviously, through my maize and blue tinted glasses, and I'm going to say that the biggest thing is Michigan has to come out and establish the line of scrimmage offensively. Come out and decide, are you going to have a mixed play call, or are you just going to be tough today and run the ball? But I think whether they have a mixed play call or not, it starts with running the ball. They have to run the ball well in the first quarter. Get Blake Corum and Donovan Edwards going. I also saw something on Twitter about rumblings of Khalil Mullings getting more play time, and I like that rumor as well. He's a tough downhill runner who's going to put his head down, put his shoulder pads down, and he's going to force you to tackle him. That's a great way to establish a line of scrimmage. Get those three guys going, but also call a fair amount of pass plays for J.J. McCarthy. Let that arm get going as well. Be balanced in your attack, and I like how things can look on the offensive end. On the defensive end, we all know it's the passing attack. Travion Henderson is good, but if you can slow down Marvin Harrison, Cade Stover, and Emeka Obuka, you are far better. Your chances of winning the game go astronomically higher than if you let those guys have a lot of fun. So I expect, and even though we talked about this a little bit earlier this week, I fully expect Michigan to go away from the letting you have the dink and dunk in this game and forcing the passing attack to actually make plays.
Both these teams like to run the ball a lot, and it's understandable given the quarterback situations for both. And that's not to talk down about J.J. McCarthy, but young man does only have 18 touchdown passes, hasn't had to be the most dynamic quarterback out there, and it honestly probably buys Michigan another year of him under center, to be completely fair and honest. But between the quarterbacks, we'll get to the running backs here in just a minute, because Blake Corum is definitely something to talk about when it comes to this game. Kyle McCord hasn't played in this game yet, and he's watched the past couple of seasons Ohio State. C.J. Stroud might be the best quarterback to come out of Ohio State in decades, and he couldn't beat Michigan. J.J. McCarthy has played in this game and been a winning quarterback in this game. When we anticipate this being a very close game, obviously the spread being just 3.5, or excuse me, just 3 points, everybody's anticipating this being a very close game. Both teams are undefeated. Both teams are 11-0, and that's only happened a handful of times, and last year it happened, and Michigan was the victor. This time around, there's going to be a lot of pressure on these quarterbacks, especially if it is a close game. With Kyle McCord not having that kind of experience and not being necessarily the C.J. Stroud type, but still being a talented quarterback in his own right, having the kind of weapons around him that he does, I would think that affecting him as much as possible in your pass rush and in your disguising of your coverages, whether you're in zone or man or whatever it is that you try to do, I think if you press the issue, if you're the Wolverines against Kyle McCord, you can do some very, very dangerous things to influence the outcome of this game as Michigan believing to be the better team. What's your kind of standpoint with Kyle McCord and his first trek into this game as a starting quarterback?
I haven't been too impressed with Kyle McCord, and not just because I'm a Michigan fan, but I also think I've gotten used to very, very, very good quarterbacks at Ohio State. JT Barrett was very good. Dwayne Haskins was very good. C.J. Stroud, very good. I'm trying to think.
Justin Fields,
very good. Like, their list of very, very good quarterbacks is long, and Kyle McCord hasn't quite been on their level yet. Not that he's not a good quarterback. He's actually done very well, because once again, Ohio State is undefeated. No matter how you want to put it, the guy's playing well, but I think this is the first true test. Like, even C.J. Stroud, like, his first year playing Michigan, it was like an eye opener. Like, you have an idea of how big the rivalry is, but like, I can't even really tell you how big the Michigan Ohio State rivalry is unless you play in it. Unless you play a sport in the Michigan Ohio State rivalry, you don't actually know how big it is. And I think a lot of quarterbacks, what either side, because I think Cade and JJ went through some of that their first year playing Ohio State as well, where you just get shocked at how big of a game it really is and what really goes into the game. And it just, you're not ready for it, because it is the biggest game in college football outside of the college football final. That's why it's called the game. It is that big, and I'm interested to see if he's able to just grasp hold of the moment and push through it and play good football, or if it startles him like it's startled a lot of recent quarterbacks on both sides.
Blake Corum does not have the production that he had last year, averaging a full yard less, not nearly as many yards, not nearly really as many carries, despite, you know, his season being cut short last year around this point. Still 888 yards, 5 yards a carry, and 20 total touchdowns. He's been really the lifeblood of the team, and that really should come as no surprise. The split between him and Donovan Edwards has been a little bit, not necessarily even, but Donovan Edwards has gotten his fair share as well, with 95 carries, 323 yards, and 3 touchdowns. He's not averaging nearly as well as he did last year as well, but still, the way Michigan has dominated in every game so far this season has been with the running game being the main focus of things, and Blake Corum being the lifeblood of this team. When it comes to Ohio State, you could go to rankings, you can do whatever you want. It's very difficult to get a full grasp of just how good a team is at one particular thing for a variety of reasons, but nonetheless, when it comes to rushing defense, you can't just look at the Buckeyes and be like, yeah, we're just gonna do what we always do, we're gonna run the ball like crazy, and we're going to we're going to impose our will against the Buckeyes. Good luck with that. You should still anticipate that Blake Corum is going to be a massive, massive impact on this game. And I think controlling the football is going to be big, because while Michigan's playmakers don't necessarily get the same name recognition, I think, as the Marvin Harrisons, as the Travion Hendersons, I mean, Blake Corum's a big name, don't get me wrong. Those guys are more explosive than they are just going to grind you out. Michigan is going to grind you out, play ball control, and win the time of possession in the field position battle. Is that going to hold up in this game? Assume Kyle McCord isn't affected by the things we just mentioned on defense. He isn't affected by the moment of the game, and he steps up and plays his best game, and he's able to get the ball out to all these explosive weapons. is the grind out mentality going to be enough for Michigan when they haven't really asked J.J. McCarthy to do much, especially since his three interception game against Bowling Green?
I mean, I wouldn't say they haven't asked him to do much. There's quite a few games out there where he's thrown for almost 200 yards and they're asking him. And obviously you're not watching as much Michigan football as I am. So like,
yeah.
I'm seeing a little more of the nuanced stuff. Like they're also asking him, like in those games where he's throwing for almost 200 yards, he's got 3, 4, 5 third and 10, 12, 14 that he's converting in those games. So like when they do ask him to throw the ball, it's a tall task. And then he steps up and does it. Or they want him to come out after Blake Corum just had a tough 3rd-and-2 run. They want him to come out and bust him over top on first down. Like, he's getting put in tough throwing positions because of the down and distance and, you know, what the defense is expecting or looking for. And he's still able to convert. So I'm not too concerned with the offense and what things will be like. The biggest thing is, can this defense continue to be the defense it's been? We saw last week, the first time they played an actual offense, things got tough for them, and they let up the most points they let up this year. Are they going to be able to contain the Ohio State offense, or are we going to run into a rubber match, and how tight is that going to be, and can Michigan win a third tight game in a row?
I think it's worth mentioning that last week Maryland was the best offense that Michigan has faced. I think Michigan's schedule is much better than a lot of people want to give it credit for, especially with all of the off-the-field stuff going on. We'll talk about Jim Harbaugh's absence from this game on the other side of the break. But when it comes to Maryland, Maryland's the best offense they've played. Maryland is also a very mistake-prone team. They make a ton of mistakes. They turn the ball over when they shouldn't. That's why they can't succeed against the elite programs in the Big Ten. Ohio State doesn't make those kind of mistakes. Kyle McCord, just 4 interceptions on the season, not many turnovers outside of that, and their defense can create turnovers as well, just as they always have been able to. So that is an interesting part of the game to keep an eye on. We'll continue talking about the game as we get you prepared for the pregame show from Learfield here on WBCK in just a little bit. We'll take a break and come back with more on Michigan hosting Ohio State today here on Mitten Madness 95.3 WBCK. Back here on WBCK, Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes. It is Mitten Madness. We're talking Ohio State at Michigan, the game leading up to pregame from Learfield IMG College. They're not called that anymore. It's just Learfield. And their presentation of the game here live on 95.3 WBCK. Getting you prepared for that, Ohio State and Michigan will be a part of our picks. We'll have our picks for 2 segments. We're going to pick even more games, bigger show. Why not pick more games? We'll do that over the last 2 segments and finish that up with Ohio State and Michigan as well. Don't want to bury the lead here, but maybe we did. Jim Harbaugh's not going to be on the sideline. He's serving the 3rd game of his 3-game suspension handed down by the Big Ten. They did that so that the Big Ten would stop its investigation, regardless of how you feel about the investigation or the findings of it, whatever. Michigan's almost done with their investigation, but it is quite interesting that it was 3 games, and it just so happened to be the 3 games that would be the most difficult for Michigan to win in this entire season, with Penn State, Maryland, and Ohio State to close things out. The emotions of the Penn State game, I think, favored Michigan, right? Harbaugh finding out that he was suspended while they were on the plane and all of that, the Michigan versus the world. Maryland had the fact that it was the 1,000th win in program history. If they could pull it off, they did. You have to do that on the road, but nonetheless, you're able to play with a lot of the emotions of that. Sure, you get Ohio State at home and you've got a 2-game winning streak on them over the past 2 seasons. There are some things that line up your way, but nonetheless, Jim Harbaugh is not on the sideline. And if this game does turn out to be close, Ryan Day is far and away the more experienced guy on the sidelines for this one. How, as far as being a head coach in big time situations, that's where he's been for the past 7 or 8 seasons. So you're giving me a look here.
Because he's...
He's just not.
You're biased.
He's not done anything. Like, and I don't think Jim Harbaugh not being on the sideline is as big of a deal as other people outside of the team think it is. This is the sixth game this year that he hasn't been on the sideline. Granted, only two of those have been against tough competition. It, you know, air quotes around that, because if you ask me, Michigan's schedule isn't actually that bad, because a lot of these teams have winning records and a lot of these teams are going bowling. But nonetheless, this team has played five games this year already without their head coach on the sideline. They're okay. They know what they're doing. And I don't think Sharon Moore is going to call this game like he called the last two. This game's different, and everyone in that program knows this game is different. I don't think it's as big as a deal.
I just want to combat the Ryan Day hasn't done anything comment with the fact that Ryan Day has more playoff wins than Jim Harbaugh does.
Jim Harbaugh did anything.
Yeah, I'm just saying, you gave me that look and then you followed it up with he hasn't done anything. Postseason representation matters.
I just want to point out
they've been successful in those.
Everybody he's gotten beaten by, he's accused them of cheating. So
true. I'm not saying Ryan Day has a fantastic attitude. I'm not saying he's somebody to root for. I'm just pointing out facts and numbers and those types of things. Ryan Day is one of the better coaches in all of college football. That doesn't mean that he's one of the greatest of all time, and it certainly should be taken with the understanding, obviously, that he is at one of the most elite football I know today of all day is not the day to really die on this soapbox, but Ohio State's one of the best programs in all of college football, and that just so happens to be where he coaches. It's hard to not be successful there. Let's just put it that way. Ryan Day has been moderately successful in his half decade tenure there, though the past 2 years losing against Michigan certainly does him no favors. Overall, I definitely see your point, and I think you talked about it a lot last week where sure, the Jim Harbaugh thing I think does matter. It does, from a schematic standpoint, from a game management standpoint, from all the little things that makes Jim Harbaugh a good football coach. You know, half his job is getting these players here and bringing in solid talent, which obviously he has done a good job of. And the fact that, you know, sure, not the greatest competition, and I outlined the circumstances of the past two games, but this is now six games where he hasn't been on the sideline. They're used to not playing with him at this point, which is kind of bizarre. And last week, the point that I wanted to mention was you talking about how this team is kind of playing for themselves at this point, right? You've got guys like Blake Corum that came back, right? And didn't necessarily have to. And you've got a team that understands it can, should, and has a very strong possibility of winning a national championship. And Ohio State stands in their way of that. That means execute. That means do what you can on the field. Sure, play calling may not always be the best. It may not filter through the system the way that it normally would with Jim Harbaugh at the helm. But if you execute what is called, you're good enough. you're more than good enough to stand up to Ohio State on your own turf, take advantage of the emotions of the situation. Especially, I want to ask you this. How much does it play in that Ohio State has so much to do with the reason that Jim Harbaugh was suspended? The fact that the Buckeye, and you mentioned Ryan Day has always been, you know, one to throw out accusations of cheating. It feeds into the rivalry, don't get me wrong. This is already an emotional game, but when we're talking about the fact that they're about to be on the field with a program that, you know, justifiably because of the rivalry, hasn't had nice things to say about Michigan and this whole air quotes cheating scandal with the sign stealing nonsense. I mean, that almost to me sounds like it favors Michigan a little bit, don't you?
You might as well throw your hands up like you do, Wade, because you just threw me the best lob ever. Of course that makes it so much better. This team wants to just, what they did to Penn State is really what this Michigan team wants to do to Ohio State, even though I know they won't. They want to come out and just run the ball 60 times right down their throat. They 1,000% want to and just prove that they're that much better. But I think it plays a huge factor into it. And I think they just want to go out there and say, sure, you did what you set out to do, got our coach sitting at home, but you still got to come out here and play football. You can't protect them boys from us. Them 18 to 26 year old men that are coming out to play on this gridiron got to come play these same 18 to 26 year old men. And guess who they're not going to be able to be saved from? Those men. They got to go out there and play football and put on the pads and hit each other. And that's what this Michigan football team is thinking about. And that's what they've been thinking about all year. They've just been serving this Michigan team motivation on a silver platter. Like, oh, we're just going to keep messing with you all year. Keep taking your coach away. Keep saying things things about this guy and that guy. And every time this team is just getting closer together and they're literally fusing as one, and they're basically just one man now. What comes out of JJ's mouth is the same thing that came out of Mikey Saverstill's mouth 2 days ago. Like, they're all just the same person now, and they're bonded over the fact that the country hates them. So how can you beat a team that doesn't want to do anything other than play for the guy next to them because that's all they have? It's like, remember the Titans. You can't beat a team that wants to play for the guy next to them because they don't have anyone else out there.
Let's shift gears to the national aspect of this before we get to our picks for the last two segments. Michigan and Ohio State obviously are number two and number three, and the winner of this game is going to go on to play Iowa. And not this, you know, Iowa wasn't great last year, but that Iowa team was much better than this Iowa team.
Only because Cade McNamara got hurt. If Cade did not get
totally
hurt,
understandable,
this would be a totally different game.
Very, very different. Iowa is number 20, and I don't want to take too much away from them, but I mean, they're a team that really celebrates the idea of punting, which I think is both very on brand and hilarious, because they're black and gold. But
before you go on, did you see the punt that Michigan's punter had last week?
No.
Couldn't have gotten a better punt. Literally, he punted this ball. It hit the 1 yard line, went up, and basically stopped on the 1 yard line.
Wow.
Impressive. It was the best punt I've seen with my own two eyes. But you can now continue about Iowa.
Nonetheless, the anticipation is whoever wins between Ohio State and Michigan will go on to beat Iowa in the Big Ten Championship and punch their ticket to the college football playoff. So that leaves in the question that I did strategically leave out earlier in the show, DJ. The loser of this game, I'm not going to say it one way or the other, whether it's Michigan or Ohio State, how much of a chance do you give them at the right kind of chaos happening to where we have a similar situation we had last year where Ohio State still managed to get into the playoff despite losing this game? Can history repeat itself this way again, or is there just too much in front of the loser of this game?
I don't think it happens. And I think it's because you're going to have possibly, if chaos starts to happen, you're still going to have three one-loss champions in front of this one-loss no champion, which is going to make it very hard for a one-loss no champion to sneak in. Say Bama beats Georgia, they're a one-loss champion. Texas wins out in the Big 12, they're a one-loss champion. Cincinnati ends up, or Louisville ends up beating Florida State in the ACC championship, they're a one-loss champion. Maybe Oregon ends up bouncing Washington and beating them in the rematch, they're also a one-loss champion. Where is there room for a one-loss no champion? There isn't. You got to win this game. That's it. You have to win this game if you want to play in the college football playoff.
This year, the loser of the game, as you mentioned, would have to worry about the Pac-12, Big 12, and ACC champions. Assuming that Washington, Florida State, and Texas all win this week, as they really should, assuming that happens, it only makes things more difficult. If any of those teams lose this week, that really does open the door more, because then even if those teams win their conference, Michigan or Ohio State, the loser of this game, would have a better argument. They really need chaos to ensue between Washington, Florida, and Texas this week rather than next week, because it does them no good if Louisville and Florida State both win out, or both win this week. And then, you know, even if Louisville beats Florida State in that scenario, it makes it more difficult for Michigan. If Wazoo wins out, it makes it more difficult. If Oregon wins out, it makes it more difficult. And really, you don't want to play with a situation where Alabama loses this week and then beats Georgia. You know, there's a lot of things that can go wrong when it comes to rivalry week in college football. But hey, they worked in Ohio State's favor last year. Maybe that'll all happen again this year. Well, we all remember 2007, right? When it comes to college football, don't take anything for granted. We'll come back and finish things out over the next two segments with our picks. We've got more games this week and more sports to choose from on this special two-hour edition of Mitten Madness that is coming to a close. Pre-game for Michigan hosting Ohio State for the game will start at 11 a.m. You're listening to 95.3 WBCK.
Detroit sports fans, Wolverines and Spartans alike,
This is your sports show, Mitten Madness, with Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes on 95.3 WBCK.
Here on Mitten Madness, 95.3 WBCK, Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes. More picks, more show, more picks. So let's get into them here in just a little bit. First, I'm not sure if we expressly announced this last week. We are going to play for a lunch or dinner for the winner. We'll have their lunch or dinner paid for. We are settling on a restaurant over time. We're going to see if we can't, work it into some sort of sponsorship or some sort of extra, ability. We're working on that behind the scenes, but nonetheless, that is what we are playing for. And unfortunately, it really looks like I'm going to be paying for Da'Jzon's dinner or lunch at the end of the season because things are not going my way.
Yeah, speaking of, last week I came in at a rough 4-2.
Don't put it that way.
And you were a little bit rougher than me at 3-3. So you are now on the year at 48-24, which is still phenomenal. And I'm coming in at 52-20. So you're only 4 games back. You're not forever and a day away. This week could actually be very good to you.
I wonder how different things would be if we did spread instead of just straight up. I don't think our records would be quite as good, but I still think, I think collectively.
I think you would be doing a ton bit better than I would be.
I think I'd be doing significantly worse, to be honest. All right, we are going to pick a couple of games that are happening between recording and the airing of the show. So there will be some games, including this first one that I have up, that have already happened. So you can laugh at us for how wrong we are, or be, have some admiration for how right we are in that event. I'm not so sure that that's the case. First game I have up is Michigan State taking on Arizona in basketball. That's a Thanksgiving game that you can check out as soon as the Lions and Packers wrap things up at Ford Field. This is a big, big game for the Spartans. Another ranked matchup for them. They did not look great against Duke. They already are reeling still from the first game loss to James Madison, and now they've got the number 3 team in the land in Arizona. DJ, who wins between the Spartans and the Wildcats?
Ooh, starting with some basketball. You are so, so nice to me.
Let it go down. This is the first basketball game that we are picking on the show.
It is. That just means that there's more coming up in the future. I'm going to be happier. The tough thing about this is I would love to see Michigan State do well. I actually really enjoy watching Michigan State basketball because it's something the school does right. But so far this year, they've had it very tough. And it's not because they don't have the pieces like I talked about earlier in the show. If you're listening on the replay, you can go back on the app and listen to the first half of the show and hear the good things I had to say about Michigan State basketball. But I think this is going to be a little bit closer game than what people think. But Arizona still comes out on top.
Yeah, I think it's very alarming that Michigan State has put all the pressure on themselves. I think, Arizona hasn't had the most difficult schedule to get things started, but they did win their game against Duke, and Michigan State did not. And Michigan State has put so much pressure on themselves from the way that they have started this season. I think they're going to be pressing a little bit, and I think they've got to eat this loss and, take one more on the chin before they can turn things back around. I'm with you. I'm going to take the Arizona Wildcats.
Gonna stay in the basketball. No, actually, I'm not going to stay in the basketball world. Sorry. I am going to stay in the football realm for my life, in the college realm as well. Florida State football going down. Swamp Wars. Jordan Travis no longer available as of right now for the Seminoles, and I don't think he's coming back anytime soon. That did not look good. Florida coming off a couple tough games. I don't think they've won their recent two. I don't have it in front of me right now.
Florida's on a 4-game losing streak.
Okay, 4-game losing streak. Do you think they have it in them to beat their wounded in-state rival, or is Florida State still that much better this year.
Gotta say, this game is in the swamp. Florida needs it to be bowl eligible. They're 5-6 at the moment, coming off that four-game losing streak. Let's just put it this way. Three of the four losses against some of the best teams in the SEC East, because Mizzou came out of nowhere. LSU really, really pounded them. And Georgia. Now, overtime loss to Arkansas, 2-point loss to Missouri, who is the number 10 team in the country. Florida's not bad. They're just quite clearly not the Florida that we were used to, you know, when, you know, it was Tebow and his band of merry convicts. This is still not going to be an easy game for Florida State, and not just because, you know, they've got to work in a new quarterback here. Best of luck to them rolling out without Jordan Travis. That said, with Tate Rodemaker, that was the first recruit under this regime at Florida State. So there's reason to believe he should be ready. Five touchdowns, zero picks. Obviously played well against North Alabama after the injury to Jordan Travis. Now's the time to step up because Florida State season's not dead. So I am, I realistically had not come to a decision yet. I think, do you go with the Cinderella story of the backup quarterback or do you go with Florida ruining everything? I'm going to go with Billy Napier and Florida. I think they're going to do it. I think they're going to end the Florida State season in heartbreak. Sorry.
That was such a roundabout way to say all of that. I'm going to keep it short and go with Florida State because I think they're still much better well around than Florida. And the quarterback position is a tough one to lose, but I think there's ways to supplement that, at least for a team at Florida stature. And a tougher game, we can have a different conversation.
Yeah, sorry. I had to talk myself into that one.
I could tell.
Another game. Sorry, I'm making a trend out of this. Another game that has already happened. This one happened on Friday. This one is Oregon hosting Oregon State. One of Bo Nix's last chances to prove that he could potentially win the Heisman Trophy. Oregon State versus the Ducks. Who do you got, DJ?
I love Oregon State and everything they've done this year. I think that they look really well. DJ, I'm not going to try and say his last name.
Uyongalale.
Has looked very well as well for the Beavers team and taken them to a level that they hadn't been at recently. But I don't think they quite have enough to beat Oregon, although they are still going bowling. So I do hope they win their bowl game.
I am I'm going for broke. I'm going to go with the Beavers. I went with Utah way back when, just before Halloween, and it didn't pay off, but it was the kind of game that Oregon would lose. Utah just didn't have enough. They were too banged up. Oregon State is healthy. I liked what I saw with them against Washington. They felt like they could have won that game. This time on the road, I think they handle business in a good old Civil War there in Oregon.
I'm going to do something we haven't done yet this year, and I'm going to take things over to the ice rink. Little Caesars Arena will be having ice down. The Bruins will be coming into town. Again, do you think the Red Wings have it in them? I may even be wrong. This game might be out at TD Garden. Either way, we're going to the ice. Red Wings, Bruins. Are they going to win or are they going to lose?
This is the third time that the Red Wings and the Bruins are matching up. And I think that this is one of the more important ones. They've split the series so far. This game is out in Boston, by the way, DJ, on Friday night. So it has already happened. So we are, oh man, another one I hadn't come to a complete conclusion on yet. I'm going to go with Boston in this one. I'm going to play it a little bit more safe. And I think the Red Wings will get them on the last one. I think they're going to lose this one. I think Boston comes back.
I like that as well. I'm also going to go with Boston, but for different reasons. I think that Boston is just better this year. They were better last year, and this is one of those games that Boston knows they have to win because it's a divisional game. Those are important, and Boston has been winning a lot of those. That's the reason why they're at the top of the division. That's our first four games. We'll be back with six more after a break. But as y'all can tell, Jacob's already got two opposite games and is trying to catch up with everything in him. So here what we got for the last six, which are absolute blockbusters, after a short break here on 95.3
WBCK.
Let's wrap up 2 hours of Mitten Madness on 95.3 WBCK. We're just a short bit away from getting you out to the pregame show in Ann Arbor as Michigan prepares to host Ohio State, number 2 versus number 3. So keep it locked in on WBCK after the show for that one. Big, big game, and one that we will pick here shortly. First, we got to take things down south back home to the Iron Bowl. We're going to pick between Alabama and Auburn. I'm going to tell you right now, DJ, as purveyor of all things SEC and as an alum of the University of Alabama.
Paul Feinbaum? Is that you?
No. What I will say is there's some voodoo out in them hills down in Auburn. Don't think that just because Auburn lost big to New Mexico State last week at home that they aren't going to bring everything in the kitchen sink and more against Alabama. Do you look at that 14.5 point spread for Alabama in favor of the Tide and laugh at it? This one's going to be a little bit closer, DJ. Who do you think's got it, though? Number 8, Alabama, or 6-5, Auburn?
I mean, as much as I want Auburn to beat Alabama so they can't even sneak into the college football playoff, they just lost to New Mexico State, dog.
Oh.
Like, you can't tell me that they're going to go out and beat Bama after that. Like, do I want to, deep down in my humblest of hearts, believe that? Yes, because that would be amazing for me as a Michigan fan. But I can't bet on that. I'm going with logistical things here in my head. And you know what the analytics say? Alabama beats Auburn most times than not.
I think the other part was you could tell that I was trying to sell you on the idea of picking Auburn and that it would do you no good to pick Auburn because you knew I was going to pick the Tide. Roll Tide. Alabama's going to win and they're going to head into Atlanta with some momentum.
Your Steelers are up on deck, sir.
Why?
They fired Matt Canada.
Yay.
Earlier this week.
Yay.
I can tell you're excited about that. But they're taking on divisional rival the Bengals, who have looked good and bad at times this year. Joe Burrow seems to be finding his stride of recent weeks.
Joe Burrow's out for the season.
But he did just get hurt.
Sorry, I stole your thunder.
Yeah, it's okay. He did just get hurt. Bad. Do the Steelers going to be able to do it without their OC? Or are the Bengals going to be able to do it without their starting QB?
I don't know. I don't know, because you guys asked me in the hall, was it a Matt Canada problem or a Kenny Pickett problem? Well, we've gotten rid of half the problem. I'm not so sure that Kenny Pickett isn't more of the problem than we were giving him credit for much of the season. The Bengals still have a very good defense. It's very similar to the Browns game last week. The one difference is Matt Canada isn't there to put his grimy little hands into this offense. The Steelers finally have their Canadian independence. I am going to go with the Steelers because I don't have any reason to go with the Bengals. I'm too loyal for my own good, even if it hurts me in these standings.
Who's the Bengals' backup quarterback?
Jake Browning.
And that's why I'm taking the Steelers. Because
Browning literally took his first legitimate NFL snaps last week. My next game, Jaguars, Texans. The last time these two got together, the Texans put the bang thing on the Jacksonville Jaguars, but now the Jags are back in first in the AFC South. CJ Stroud just came off of a 3-interception game in which they still won because they played Arizona. Arizona's not very good. Nonetheless, Houston has looked incredible all season given the circumstances of where their franchise is and has been. Trevor Lawrence played his best game last week as well in a big win over Tennessee. That coming off of one of his worst games ever against San Francisco. How do you see this one playing out? The Texans are on the road.
What a lot of people don't know is CJ Stroud is on my fantasy team. And CJ Stroud has been a fantasy monster. And CJ Stroud might be the best turnover machine I've seen. The guy's averaging like 2.5 turnovers a game and he's still winning them. He's still throwing for 300 yards and 3 TDs. Like, sure, you got 2 fumbles and a pick, but when you got 400 yards and 4 TDs, I don't care. And you win the game, I don't care. This dude is turning the ball over at an unreal rate, yet still winning the game. You know who turns the ball over at an unreal rate and doesn't win those games when he does that?
Ouch.
Trevor Lawrence.
Ouch. I didn't deserve that, DJ. That was targeted.
I am going to stick with CJ Stroud on this one. And I like the Texans to win again, even though it's hard to beat a divisional rival twice in a year.
I mean, I'm going to do the dumb thing here, DJ. You know I am. And it only helps because you pick the Texans. I'm going to do the dumb thing here, and I'm going to back my guy, Trevor Lawrence, and hope that he is legitimately hitting his stride and that they were just like my Steelers, one of those teams that got caught in the whirlwind that was the unexpected eruption of the Houston Texans. And I think the Jags can get them back on the road. I don't know why, but I'm going to trust Trevor Lawrence, Travis Etienne, Christian Kirk, and the whole band of merry Jaguars to help me catch up. Give me the Jags.
I am going to keep it in the NFL, and I'm going to ask you about a team that played earlier this week against another really good team and won the Kelce Bowl and the Eagles. Swift Bowl. Or the Swift Bowl. However you want to put that. The Eagles, now reigning supreme to Taylor Swift and owning her rights as a fan, will take on the Buffalo Bills this week, who have been struggling but finding ways to win football games. Also, Stephon Diggs hasn't looked good, which has been the worst part of my fantasy team in the recent weeks.
77 catches, 195 yards, 7 touchdowns doesn't look good.
I said in the recent weeks, my guy. Do the Bills have enough to beat an Eagles team?
I think,
or are the Eagles just too good right now?
I think the Bills actually are going to get a ton of momentum off that Jets win. I wonder how much of a bugaboo it was to lose that first game to the Jets, even after Aaron Rodgers left the game, and how much that played into their psyche. Plus, once they fired Ken Dorsey, the offensive coordinator, that lights a fire under most teams. And I think just the feeling of dominating another program feels good to the Bills. The Eagles are the worst 9-1 team I think I've ever seen. The Eagles are very good. They're very talented. I was very impressed last night with their comeback victory over the Chiefs, but the Chiefs are also really bad, especially in the second half, and especially if they're forced to throw the ball to their receivers because they cannot catch. Your guy MVS, man, he really let them down again on Monday night. I'm going to trust the Bills. I think Josh Allen has figured a few things out. I think they're learning to lean on their running game. I think Shakir is kind of stepping up in that place of consistency that Gabe Davis consistently leaves wide open. I'm going to take the Bills, and I think they're going to get to 7-5 and drop the Eagles down to 9-2.
Ooh, you are really playing it crazy this week trying to catch up. I'm going with the Eagles. Like, I can't deny they're 9-1. They're 9-1. They don't lose. They've lost one time, and it was what a lot of people are saying is a fluke loss, because that was the same time that San Francisco had their fluke loss. There must have just been something in the NFL, water or air or something at the time.
Lost to the Jets, by the way.
They lost to the Jets. You know who else lost to the Jets? This Bills team.
Not most recently.
Sure. Sure.
They just beat the Jets 32-6 and got them to finally bench Zach Wilson.
I need them to actually beat the Eagles, and I don't think that happens.
So you're going with the Eagles?
Oh, yeah. 1,000%.
Okay.
Wouldn't even think twice.
Last one I've got is you kind of threw up the challenge flag a little bit at me when I told you that I was going to bring this game to the table. This is going to close out the insane Thursday lineup that Detroit sports has. I mentioned it before. Article on BCK kind of spills it all out, is that the Detroit area sports scene is insane from Wednesday all the way through to this game on Monday at Little Caesars Arena. The Washington Wizards come to town to play the Detroit Pistons. Usually we pick games between really good teams. That is usually kind of the moniker. That's what we're supposed to do. At the time of recording, the Wizards are 2-11 and 1-6 on the road. At the time of recording, the Detroit Pistons are 2-13 and 1-6 at home. Something has to give. The Pistons have a 56.2% chance to win, according to the ESPN matchup predictor. DJ, who gets presumably win number 3.
I gotta be a homer here and just trust the Pistons to get back on track against a team that is also struggling. I also just not a huge fan of who the Wizards have on their team. They haven't really been exciting to me in the last couple years, so I gotta rock with my Pistons on this one.
Looking at trends, the Wizards are getting absolutely crushed on a regular basis. The Pistons are just not finishing. I think this gives the Pistons an opportunity to learn how to finish, so I am going to pick the Detroit Pistons, and not necessarily for homer reasons. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I just think this is the kind of game that Detroit should, could, and can, and will win.
All right. The honors go to none other than me, because they should, as a homer. The game down I-94 in the Big House in Michigan Stadium. Definitely over 110,000 people will be in the seats. It's literally coming on this station in a few moments. The Trash State Buckeyes are making their way up north to take on the world-class University of Michigan Wolverines. Who's taking home the W, Jacob?
Well done on the intro. Michigan, 3-point favorites, 54.8% chance to win on the matchup predictor, 46.5 points on the over-under. Place your bets now because time is running out. J.J. McCarthy is incredible. Blake Corum is incredible. Roman Wilson is incredible. The Michigan Wolverines defense is incredible, and they've played incredible without Jim Harbaugh. That said, Ohio State, they've got their head coach. They've got Kyle McCarthy. backcourt. They've got Travion Henderson. They've got Marvin Harrison Jr. They've got Cade Stover. They've got weapons, man. They're dangerous, and they've looked better against equal opposition. And they're playing in Ann Arbor. They're playing in the Big House. They're playing against a team that has so much emotion wrapped up in it. And here's the funny thing about rivalries is somehow the emotion of a rivalry game plays into your favor. All it takes is Michigan doing something scary early in this game and proving that they don't need the signs, dog. They've got the talent. They don't need all of this nonsense that Ohio State and the rest of the Big Ten came after them for because they were scared Michigan had finally gotten over the hump in some ways. Michigan on the back of Blake Corum is going to dominate this game. And I don't mean on the scoreboard. I mean the way they dominated Penn State. And I don't mean they're going to not throw the ball in the second half. I just mean that physicality of Michigan is going to outwork Ohio State. I asked the question earlier, could Michigan play the traditional game, win the field position battle, win the time of possession battle, run the rock? Could they do those type of things? I asked you, but in my head, I had already answered the question. Yes, Michigan can do all of those things. And when you do all of those things, win the turnover differential as well as a boot, hey, you're going to win the football game 9 times out of 10. Michigan, I think they're going to win this football game.
Well, there you have it. We're both in an interesting week of picks. Going to be in for it. I'm taking Oregon. You're taking Oregon State. We're both taking the Bruins. We're both taking the Pistons. Both taking the Wolverines. Both taking the Tide. I'm taking the Seminoles. You're taking the Gators. I've got the Texans. You've got the Jaguars. I've got the Eagles. You've got the Bills. We both got the Steelers. And both have Arizona. This is a good chance for you to hop back in, man.
Or a good chance to just completely fall out of it.
Like, you lose some of these games, man, you might as well just start thinking about where you're going to be paying for it.
Hey,
it's going to be
if I lose some of the ones that you lost, then it doesn't matter.
That's true. That's fair. But I don't know about that, man.
We got to make reservations soon, though.
Facts. Yeah, we are. Get us on out of here, bro.
All right, that'll do it. 2 hours of Mitten Madness. Next week, Coach's Corner, Bill Broderick will be back in their regular time slot of 9 a.m. And this show will be back in its regular time slot of 10 a.m. If you missed any of the second hour, you can catch it only on the app. If you missed just the first hour, then you can check that all out in the replay at 8 p.m. or as well in the app where the entire show will be podcasted. That's going to do it for us. Stay tuned because Michigan football, as the Wolverines host the Ohio State Buckeyes, will be here live on WBCK immediately following the show. Stick around for more great sports talk here on Mitten Madness each and every week at 10 a.m. on Saturdays here on 95.3 WBCK.
Join Jacob Harrison and Da'Jzon Hughes every Saturday morning at 9 a.m. for Mitten Madness on 95.3 WBCK. Miss the show or want to play it back? Stream Mitten Madness live or on demand on the 95.3 WBCK app.